Sheikh Muhammad Yahya al-Sayyid al-Nindawi. He's come all the way from the USA for this talk, and mashallah, he's someone who studied majority in Syria and many other places across the world. He comes from a family of scholars. He's descended back from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself. He comes from a family of scholars, and he started his studies with his father, getting many ijazas in different fields of Islamic study. Moving on then to study at Al-Azhar and defeat of many scholars across the world, including the Habib and Hudra Bab. And he has ijazas in many aspects of Islamic sciences, tafsir and so on. A great scholar, alhamdulillah, and a great speaker, and I'm very blessed, very honored to present him to be the final speaker for today on returning to unity. JazakAllah khair.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وافضل الصلاه واتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى اله واصحابه اجمعين. اللهم لا علم لنا الا ما علمتنا انك انت العليم الحكيم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما والحقنا بعبادك الصالحين. اما بعد، فالسلام عليكم ورحمه الله تعالى وبركاته. Couple of things. The brother I love lesson has very good thinking about everybody else. So he praised me in terms that I'm not worthy of. That's one. I'm a student of knowledge at best. Number two, I did study with the Habayib, who are originally Hadramis, but in Hijaz, not in Hadramut. Sayyid Abdul Qadir Sayyaf and some of the Shuyukh in Mecca and Medina, who were originally Hadramis, not people in Hadramis. Now may Allah bless all of them. And the other thing he said, that I came from the US, I literally just did. I just arrived maybe about an hour ago and I went to the hotel. So because my mind is a little bit, you know, you have that circadian rhythm, day is night and night is day and all these things. So when I went to the hotel, I just took a piece of paper and jotted some notes down to say about the academic topic that I was assigned to, which is the ethics of disagreements in Islam. Let me start with the hadith of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, obviously first with the ayah of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِن تَبْسِمْنَا قَرْحِ فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Which means if you disagree in anything, the ayah is very clear. If you disagree in anything, then you should take it to Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you believe in Allah and the Day of Judgment. The reason for disunity in this ummah stems really in the differences and the disagreements and how the disagreements evolved and crystallized in such a way that the least you can say about today is terrible. Let me just take it from a different point of view. Hadith Shadu Sahih had Sayyidina Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, Hudhayfa bin Yaman. And he used to say, he would go, Sayyidina Hudhayfa is the secret keeper of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to give him the list of the munafiqeen, if you all remember. Like he used to say, I used to sit next to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, behind Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they would come and ask him about the good things to do. Yani sahaba radiallahu anhu ajma'in, they would say, Ya Rasulullah, what is good to do, what is good to do? So he would tell them. He said, Hudhayfa said, Hudhayfa's policy and strategy said, he said, and I used then to ask him about the evil things, so I can avoid. So, before we come to this, to the possible solution for the disagreement of amongst the ummah and the ethics of agreement, or the ethics of disagreement amongst the ummah, we ought to know the difference. We ought to know the reasons for differences in the first beginning. Obviously, I don't. Number one, like I said, I'm a student of knowledge, belonging to Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. I don't assume that what I say is infallible, nor do I think my words have any weight in front of the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Again, it's a deduction. The second thing I'd like to say is, it is not wrong
to do self-criticism. Al-Quran always instructed us, implicitly and explicitly, to do constructive criticism. إن الله لا يغير ما بقوم حتى يغير ما بأنفسهم. Allah does not change the status, the situation of people until they change themselves. We try to shift the blames. The blame is this, the blame is that, the blame is this. While the Quran insists over and over again that we have only ourselves to blame. So therefore, I'd like to take from this that when we do self-criticism, it is constructive with all the love. Because there is a difference between Islam and Muslims. Muslims try to reach and arrive to the level of Islam. So therefore, when we do constructive criticism of our own Muslim community, it does not mean we're criticizing Islam. The same thing, when we criticize ourselves as Ahl-Sunnah, it does not mean we're criticizing the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as the Quran and the Sunnah are the standard for everyone to follow. Obviously, I also believe in following the Madahib. The madhahab al-matbu'a, madhahab al-a'imma of al-sunnah al-jama'a, Imam Abu Hanifa, al-Shafi'i, Imam Malik, al-Awza'i, al-Sufyan, al-Abi Thawr, al-Tabari, al-Bukhari, all of them, Ibn Abi Layla, they all have madhahab. Lakin madhahab that are written and done. Lakin obviously, our following is based on the book of Allah, Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-Islam mandates that we only attribute ourselves to Islam. Huwa sammakum al-Muslimin. He named you, the ayah says clearly, he named you Muslims. So saying I follow this school or that school is simply to differentiate the source and the methodology of substantiating something. It is not meant to say that because I follow this school of fiqh, then the rest are wrong and I am better. Because such attribution of yourself to such school becomes sinful if you think you are better and the rest of the Muslims are not good. Also, it is not following one school or another, it's not to disable the self-criticism either. Because oftentimes in such following, we disable self-criticism. So we don't see our mistakes, but we see everybody else. With tafakhur, you know, that's showing that we're better, that this is where Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, it's sahih, da'uha fa'innaha natina. Abandon this, it stinks. I am better, you're better, inna akramakum inna Allahi atqaakum. Also, the students of knowledge, and I know all of you, alhamdulillah, are students of knowledge and scholars in your fields. We must differentiate between criticism of our own state so we can arrive at the level that we need to be, the Islamic level that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam brought, or Sahaba radiallahu anhu ajma'in followed, and between the criticism that is aimed at criticizing Islam. And I mentioned that, I think I should not go into more of this. More importantly, and I think that's also important, what I'm saying does not mean to belittle the refutation of the bid'ahs, nor the refutation of people who innovate and have evil innovations. Absolutely not. Lakin when we refute each other based on assumption of a bid'ah, we need to always remember that the other is also Muslim. So we preserve the right of Islam. Al-Muslim, يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حديث صحيح. يقول صلى الله عليه وآله المسلم أخو المسلم لا يخبره ولا يظلمه ولا يخذله. Does not belittle him. Does not do ظلم to him. Does not humiliate him. Even when you disagree and you're refuting a bid'ah in your opinion, then we need to make sure that we're preserving the lines of Islam, we're not violating the rules of Islam. Those are just broad parameters before we enter to the point here. How did this disagreement emerge and evolve so big and we became so crystallized How did the Ummah get so divided so drastically? Well, I'll just take you slightly back to history. And the Muslim at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, any Muslim at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, used to learn the deen entirely, comprehensively. يعني إيمان أحكام وأخلاق. إيمان إيمانيات أحكام أخلاق. One lump sum. There was no separation between the إيمانيات, which is called now عقيدة. By the way, عقيدة is an innovative term. مصطلح مستحدث يعني. Innovative term. Nowhere in the Book of Allah or the Sunnah of the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم صحيح or ضعيف حديث. And nowhere in any of the Sahaba is an عقيدة. ولا comes from عقدة يعني to tie your heart on something and it came later on. Anyway, so I call it إيمانيات. Let's say call it إيمانيات. So there was no separation in the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم between إيمانيات and عمليات. What you believe in and what you practice. In other words, what you believed in was what you practiced. Okay. What we call nowadays aqidah, at the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, was simply the six usul. If you want to call them six usul, that is an innovative term by me or other people that use that. Or the six things, yeah, hadith mentioned them, hadith al-Bukhari. And tu'mana billahi, what is the Maryam aqidah at that time? You believe in Allah. وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر والقضاء والقدر خيره وشره عند الله. In Allah, the day of judgment, his books, his messengers, and the decree of Allah. This was what إيمانيات. Okay. Obviously, even these إيمانيات were not so much expanded upon like they are nowadays. يعني even the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم, they used to believe in these إيمانيات in their generality, in their general meanings, without, most of them, without going through the specifics and the details that were later on added to what we call Aqidah. In fact, in Arabi, the Bedouin used to come to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, hadith صحيح, all of you know it, it's متواتر في السيرة, يعني ذكر العلماء many times, a Bedouin used to come to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and would stay with him few, some little time. He teaches him Islam. Simple. And this man, this Bedouin, goes back to his town in the desert or wherever he lives, never comes back, never sees the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم again, and no one doubts his Islam or Iman, let alone his companionship. Though that Bedouin, or that Sahabi then, does not really know most of these things that nowadays people put it and incorporate it in what they call Aqidah versus this versus that and this, you know, all these things that we do. Which eventually came because of the sectarian differences amongst the Muslims, between because of the political differences amongst the Muslims, etc. How did these things, this is how so we started expanding what we call Imaniyah, then we says Aqidah. And everyone, every group says, this is the Aqidah, that's the Aqidah, and there's, that's the Aqidah. And then it started expanding and expanding based on political, based sometimes on ideological, based on whatever it is, grouping that they have to do. I don't want you to think that this is a new thing, that you see it nowadays. Nowadays I see it. This group says this group is bid'ah, and the other group is kafir. No, this is old. If you go back to the 4th century, and the 3rd century, and the 5th century, you find these things, unfortunately, still in our books. So the mistake is old. And everyone claims they have a Salaf. Salaf means predecessors. I don't mean anything I'm saying to single out one group versus the other. I just want to make that clear, so we're not, you know, coming from, inshallah, the Ma'ida or the table of Islam. But everyone says, well, because I'm doing this tafsir and tabdi' and this takfir and this of this group and that group, because I have the ulama in the old days from the Salaf, from the pious predecessors said so. The problem with this term is very vague and ambiguous term, because everybody has a Salaf, everybody has a predecessor. In other words, the predecessors of the Hanbalis were not like the predecessors of the Hanafis, even in the old days. Of the Ash'aris who are not like the Hanbalis, of the, and then Zahiris, and then all of those the predecessors of all of those were different from the Salaf of the Shia and the Khawarij and the Rawafid, etc., etc. Everyone has a Salaf. And therefore, the problem becomes then the Salaf or the predecessors or the pious predecessors, even that term becomes very limited to the specific group that's presenting it. And furthermore, being in the circle of the Salaf is determined not by being in the time of the Salaf and being a Muslim, no, but it's determined by which group of the Salaf you belong to. And then you're used. So you see people using four or five names, you know, Ibn Battah, والبربعاري والخلال والسكر والمنده. This is the Salaf. Well, there was other Salafs also that had different opinions to that. Again, not against any school. What is the result? Result is nowadays the youth and anyone who wants to look at everything in a complete picture will find himself forced by many groups and most groups to look at Islam from their own binoculars. But not only that, that if he was not to look through those very binoculars, then his own intentions and deen and even sincerity is questioned. The result is the Ummah remains, putting all its efforts and all its money and all its capacity and all its thinking and all its intelligence to be creative, to destroy each other from within each other. That's the result. Creativity will be decreased, we're gonna be busy, and we're gonna overcome the glory of Islam. We don't see it anymore because we're looking from a microscope, we're not looking from a telescope. Therefore, we only see the little problems, we don't see the glory of Islam. The vast, general goals and objectives of Islam, of the things that are important, such as the Tawheed, such as the Rahmah, such as the positive contribution to yourself, your community, and your society. Al-Hath al-Ilm, acquiring knowledge, tafakkur, tadabbur, understanding, practicing what we know. Very important, big things. No, but we come to little minute things, and we can't give them names, مَا أَنْزَى اللَّهُ بِهَا مِنْ سُلْطَانٍ, and we say this is Islam, and then we want to tell people this is this narrow-minded, this is what the Prophet ﷺ used to teach and the Sahaba used to be like. And that's when groups, all these things. The solution is difficult. Because the solution needs not only research and study below or beyond the superficials, the basics, the ABCs, but it also needs allocation of sincere people who are willing to do all these things so we can fudge these gaps and finesse the differences instead of actually putting all of our goals and capacities to further entrench the division amongst Muslims and obviously doing dhulm on them and amplifying their work. If they make a mistake, it's amplified. And then we cover our own little mistakes. Obviously, such kind of an advice is going to be difficult to be accepted because when people are busy committing dhulm onto others to make themselves look better, they have no time to think injustice. Why don't we try it? Because we're either wanting the dunya, we want to be praised, we want to be in positions, we want people to call and say, this is the shaykh so-and-so, this is the man. Or we want to be called, we are good in the sunnah, we are, you know, strong. Pakka whatever you want. We want to be known like that. Or we're fearful from the retribution of people. Or we're simply ignorant of the core and the soul of Islam, the message of Islam of the Prophet ﷺ. Therefore, you see many of the groups, the priority is their own books. And the call of the others is to the content of those books more than the call for the content of the Qur'an and the content of the authentic sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And then obviously we put the good titles to our people and our shuyukh, and we always belittle and take the titles away from other people and other shuyukh of other groups. And therefore Islam now has many different names, no longer one name. And therefore many of those groups do not find
yourself, calling yourself Muslim is sufficient. It's no longer sufficient.
What kind of group do you belong to? So being Muslim by itself is no longer sufficient. Now I'm talking general. I'm not talking again any specific group. Keep in mind that every single group, even the Khawarij, until today, claim that they follow the book and the Sunnah. Okay. That's just the claim that everybody says, including us at the Sunnah wal Jama'ah. We claim to follow the book and the Sunnah, and everyone else claims to follow the book and the Sunnah. And then, obviously, what separates all these things is the actions. Who is the one who benefits from all this? The one who benefits, obviously, those who don't like Islam. I'm not saying I don't really believe that they necessarily did that on purpose. No, 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 we did that. We volunteered to do all these things, to get busy in dividing ourselves and implementing all these things. What are the reasons? Many things. The first, let me go through them real quick because we're running out of time. Number one, lots of lies and weak narrations. Forgeries in narrations, weak narrations. Used everywhere. I'm not gonna, you want me to give you the books, I'll give you the books and the pages and all these things. Yeah. And also using it, especially in aqaid, or let me take that back, in imaniyat. What is narrated, throughout Quran Ahmad, for example, in the Sunnah, that wa'ayyadu billah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sits on the kursi and he gives four fingers to the Prophet. Crazy stuff. He saw Allah as a young man, shab, amrajah. He has curly hair, he looks like a young man. All this, and if this is not anthropomorphism and likening Allah to the creation, I don't know what is. Obviously, not only that, but substantiation of these asanid this week, but we still use them when we put them out there. So using these forgeries and weak narrations to substantiate a point. Number two, reasons for differences, obviously, we used our own group mentality to subjugate the discarding and authentication. جرح and تعديل of people. Ibn Hajar says, for example, about Ibn Battah, Ibn Battah al-Hanbali from the Imam from the old days. He says, no, I read for Ibn Battah something, شَعَرَّ مِنْهُ جِلْدِي. I had goosebumps from him. When Ibn Battah says, basically, that Allah talked to Musa, he had a jubbah, milsuf, an imam from wool. Obviously, it's hadith. But Ibn Hajar says that as Ibn Battah forged the asaneed so it looks good to that hadith. So we use the knowledge then to substantiate something. Same thing like Ibrahim bin Yaqub al-Jarzajani. He used jarh and ta'deel, authentication, discarding of the people, simply in his own, because he thought, though he's an imam, and he is kada, hafiz, thiqa, etc. Lakin to use what? To discard people he did not like. Number three, contradictions, general contradictions you find in all the groups. What are the general contradictions? You see them, book and sunnah, book and sunnah, book and sunnah, book and sunnah. We return back to the book and sunnah. When it comes to tawheed, let's make tawheed three kinds. And then based on the three kinds, let's say, if you don't believe in one of the kinds, you're not Muslim. Wait a minute. The three kinds were not in the book and the sunnah. So now you're saying we need the three kinds because it's easier explanation. Fine. We let you have it as an easier explanation. But why do you put consequences of kufr and bid'ah to those who don't take your explanatory method? There is contradiction. We contradict that there's contradiction from going extreme. But then there's extreme in every single one. You see the groups, when they are not, they say follow the jama'ah, don't leave the jama'ah. When there's not many, they say, the mu'mineen are always few. Contradictions and things. When we cite the ijma', and the ijma' is not like at that point, they say, no, Ahmad says, whoever calls ijma' is a liar. And that ijma' kadhib. There's no ijma'. Who came ijma' with who? What are you talking about ijma'? Lakin when there's another ways, there's, no, let's cite the ijma'. We have contradictions in the Sahaba, radiallahu anhu. So while we denounce the Shia, rightfully so, for slandering the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'een, we forget also to denounce those who not only cursed Abu Bakr wa Umar radiallahu anhum, the best of the Sahaba, but also those who cursed Ali.
حريث بن عثمان الحمصي، زيد بن ثور بن يزيد، زيد يزيد، etc. other people.
Fourth reason of the differences, not only contradiction, we don't understand the evidence of the other. We don't want to understand the evidence. No, I don't want to listen to the evidence. Number five, flat out ظلم to those we disagree with. We do ظلم to them, oppression. Oh, he doesn't know, they don't know anything. These guys, they just want to what? They are deniers of the attributes of Allah, as if they don't, as if they're denying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody wants to deny any attributes.
Abu Hanifa, say that Abu Hanifa, Imam al-Azam, he used to carry out the Islam urwatan urwa.
He used to destroy Islam piece by piece. Dhulm, flat out dhulm for those who disagree with. This is, I call it intellectual terrorism. First, you terrorize the other intellectually. He does, they're sits, they're evil, they're out there to uproot Islam under the name of Islam, they're out there to do these things. This kind of intellectual terrorism leads to actual terrorism against the other, which also happened, and that's the sixth reason for differences amongst the Ummah, where the many, many things you ask, look at Ibn Jarir Tabari, the Mufassir, Sahib al-Tafsir al-Tarif. Ibn Jarir, the Hanbalis at the time, they gathered him, they gathered around his house, they beat him, they almost killed him, and they called him, you are Rafidi and you are Mulhid. Anybody who does, they don't like you, so Rafidi and Mulhid, you don't believe, and they killed him. La Abd al-Hathir also, in his tarif, mentioned in the year 323, that many of the Hanbalis at that time, they came to the people that they didn't like, and they used to call them names, they make up accusations, just that. Or they used to use the blind people to beat the people they don't like in the masajid. Al-Faqih al-Buri Shafi in year 576, also the Hanbalis, they gave him a little piece of sweet and they got rid of him through poison.
I mean, literal terrorism against each other. Ibn Thawrak, Abu Bakr ibn Thawrak, Al-Allama al-Ash'ari,
okay,
was also poisoned as well through the Karamiya, who were very related to the Hanbalis at that time. Intellectual terrorism, dear brothers, leads to actual terrorism against the other, because now you say they don't have the right to live. Let me throw a bomb in their masjid.
We kill them, get rid of them. They're against the Sunni, demonizing your opponent. Number seven, simply forgeries on the others. Yani saying that, for example, it's okay, we are a Sunni different than the Mu'tazila, different than the Jahmiyyah, different than the Shia, different than the Khawarij.
But we don't need to make up lies to make our cause.
So we say, Al-Mu'tazila deny Adab al-Qabr, they don't, for example.
Not defending them, but they don't.
The Shia now, the Twelvers, they deny the Quran, they have another Quran, they don't.
That's not true. Let's be objective in our, so we can articulate our points correctly.
This is not to say that they are not deviants. This is not to say that they are out of the Sunnah, but this is to say that we and the Sunnah Jama'ah are to be just in our articulation. My father, rahmatullahi alayhi, used to say, if you cannot articulate your opponent's points and evidences as well as you can articulate your own, you have not even started to understand. That's how we can get to it. That's how we can come close. But no, you say this and I say this and this tarasho. You know, I'm throwing accusations and you think,
iftira. Okay, and not only that, tara, they also made iftira, they forged on Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu. Remember, they said what? They said, supposedly, Abu Hanifa would never say that. He said, Abu Hanifa said, if the Nabi was in my time, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would have taken lots of my opinions.
Who would ever say? You, anybody who doesn't know anything would not say that.
Like, and just forgeries,
just throw these things. And by the way, we did not only use the humans, we also brought the jinn in. Oh, we have narrations from the jinn. The jinn said so and so. Number eight, Irhab al-Mutawakkifin, which means what? We terrorize those who don't follow.
If you have doubt in the kufr of those, you're kafir.
Not only that, I doubt, just not gonna just terrorize them. I'm gonna terrorize anyone who's not.
If you have a doubt in the kufr of the Jahmiyyah,
the Jahmiyyah at that time they called
Ash'ari wal Maturidiyya wal Jahmiyyah, because they say Allah does not exist in a place. That's what our belief is.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not exist in a place. Allah is the creator of places.
Oh, and
okay. Number nine, being silent on our group, but being out loud on denouncing other group. Number 10, being extreme in our figures.
No matter what you it is,
whether it's Salafi or Sufi. I know people say the Shia are very extreme in the glorifying their imams, and the Sufis are very extreme in glorifying their shuyukh. Every group, even the so-called Salafis, are also, and again, I'm not talking about anyone in particular, but they're also, they have also extreme elements. And if you want to know about, for example, Ibrahim Wasti, who talks about Ibn Taymiyyah, who is a prominent Salafi figure, obviously, he says he looks at the Lawh al-Mahfuz, or as if he's looking at the order, this is what,
if the Sufi says that, he says, you know, crazy these people are.
So, extreme in the shuyukh and in the figures of people.